Hello everyone, welcome back to the channel and to another episode of What TV Shows I Saw This Month, October 2023 edition. Happy Halloween if you celebrate, happy spooky season for all you horror buffs, and happy Swift season, because that also happened. October was overall a decent month for TV, a couple new releases, a healthy amount of overlap, and thanks to the writer's strike finally coming to an end, a few long-awaited returns. Which is what I'd like to start with, beginning with SNL, which was pretty solid overall with hosts including Bad Bunny, Nate Bargatze, and a season opener helmed by Pete Davidson, who was supposed to host last season until the strikes put a stop to that. I do think this show will be the one to keep an eye on, how they intend to deal with the ongoing actor strike, mainly because as much as I love comedians and musical guests pulling double duty as much as the next guy, SNL has always worked best with seasoned, trained actors to hold their own during skits. See the Bad Bunny episode for how not to do this effectively. And I also think that, especially compared to other late-night shows on currently, SNL is the series that is most dependent on its guests. But I understand that they're doing what they can to at least put a show together every week, which I imagine can't be easy under normal circumstances, let alone these strikes. So I have to respect them for that, particularly when you place it next to the other late night programs like Seth Meyers, Jimmy Kimmel, Fallon, Colbert. They all also came back in October as well, but mostly filled their airtime with musicians or pre-planned segments, like a 30-minute closer look in Seth's case, which is a pretty familiar format to another big return for this month, Last Week Tonight, which came back strong with segments on prison healthcare, food safety, homeschooling, and many more. All bangers, in my opinion. This show does not lose its edge, and is certainly still one of the sharpest and wittiest series on TV right now, and Oliver himself seems to be as John Oliver as ever, which is a real treat for sure. Since I was deep in that John Oliver side of YouTube, I was getting recommended clips from Patriot Act with Hasan Minhaj, another series that is firmly set in this political satire slash faux journalism type of genre, and since I'm a huge John Oliver fan, I figured this would be up my alley. And unsurprisingly, it very much is. The John Oliver comparisons are inevitable, but one thing I like about this show a lot are the topics they choose to cover, how there's very little overlap, surprisingly, to that of Oliver, even with trending topics. When these shows were airing alongside each other, they rarely covered the same issues, which I suppose is a reminder that our world is massive and has a lot of shit wrong with it. Hasan is super fun and charismatic. He's got a naturally cool aesthetic to him, not posted behind a desk with a suit and tie like his contemporaries. He's on a brightly lit stage in $1,200 sneakers with camera work so fluid, you'd think they'd go through entire pallets of DW40. But that said, I don't think the show is as funny. This show is smile funny, whereas Oliver, to me at least, is roll off the couch funny. But in terms of how informative it is, I've learned a lot about our broken world through Hasan, and that's always something I'm down for. I got to check out a few movies this month that I want to talk about as well, including the special re-release of the iconic 1984 Talking Heads concert film Stop Making Sense, which had a special 4K remastered cut distributed by A24, and it was an absolute blast. I watched this one with my dad and my brother, who had both seen it prior plenty of times, but this was my first screening of it, and it was simply magnetic. David Byrne is a way, 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 way better guitarist and frontman than the internet tends to give him credit for. Like, I know Talking Heads are in that league of music nerd, Fantano core type of act, and they do certainly get plenty of praise, but seeing the live performances of these tracks with such energy and stamina and passion from Byrne and company is so special. The music itself is great, I've been a fan of this band for a long time, but this movie made me appreciate it in a different way than I had prior, partly due to how captivating everyone's stage presence is, and also the sets and the light work. It's just all so artsy in a way that only Talking Heads can make work. Do yourself a favor and check this puppy out soon, it is truly a once-in-a-lifetime experience. There it is, I was missing that last time around, ah. Feels good to be back, y'all. Horror, to be honest, isn't really my thing, but seeing that it is October, I had to watch at least one show in the genre, and recently I'd been hearing about this Hulu series called The Other Black Girl getting some buzz and decided to give it a watch. and I'm glad I did, because I enjoyed this a lot more than I was expecting to. The show follows Nella Rogers, an editorial assistant at a large New York-based book publishing house named Wagger Books, who, being the only black employee at the company, often feels left out and ignored in an atmosphere controlled by mostly white men. When a new hire named Hazel enters the picture, Nella and her instantly hit it off, giving them each someone to lean on and depend on in a prejudiced world. However, when Hazel's past starts to be revealed, her bubbly, charming exterior isn't quite what it seems. This show clearly takes inspiration from the new age race-themed horror projects of the last few years, like Jordan Peele's work, for instance, and corporate office dramas like Succession or Severance, and blends the two styles seamlessly to create intense edge-of-your-seat watch while also delivering big belly laughs from its talented backing cast. Let me just say, you are not gonna see Kevin Malone the same way after this. I swear, fellas, Brian Bumgarner is a national treasure, and we have to protect him from all harm. He plays this character so well, despite the fact that this person is the type of guy who, wouldn't use black beans in his chili, if you catch my drift. But it's that amount of borderline cartoony behavior that's surprisingly common to see in real life that makes this one engrossing drama that's a binge-worthy watch. Now, Hulu, if you can this one, after leaving it on a cliffhanger, just like you did last time with How I Met Your Father, I swear I will personally show up to your corporate office and paint that bitch red like my name was Doja Cat, motherfuckers. And while we're sticking with the horror theme here, my most anticipated show of the month was one that I feel like a lot of people missed out on, and that was Goosebumps on Disney Plus. Why was I so interested in this one, you may ask? Well, for my money, Goosebumps has always been one of the most reliable and consistent franchises in all of entertainment, and over the course of many different mediums, has delivered creepy stories with a humorous twist. The video games, movies, books, and of course the original 90s anthology series have all effectively provided scares to their audience, and now this serialized, mature take on the format continues on that front without feeling a hair out of place. The obvious commentary to make against this show would be how now it all feels. Like, if the prompt 2023 TV show was put into ChatGPT, this is what it would spit out. Meaning, it checks all the boxes on how TV shows tend to be produced nowadays. A very inclusive, diverse cast, awkward teen slang, needle drops of current and past hits that are a bit too on the nose, and a slew of parodies and homages to popular media of the past. Not to mention it being a reboot trying to capitalize on nostalgia from a now older audience looking to recapture some of their youth. But as I've stated many times on my channel, that sort of stuff doesn't bother me. I don't mind reboots or remakes, especially when they're done this well. And as I mentioned before, Goosebumps as a whole is such a consistent franchise that's hard to go wrong with. I'm enjoying it a lot, and I hope that maybe, if you were on the fence about it, you'll give it a chance, because I think this is one of the most engrossing shows I've seen all year. Another new show that had their season premiere in October was La Mesa Mexa on Bytes. This one hosted by MasterChef winner Claudia Sandoval, in which she shows traditional Mexican dishes while also serving up colorful cocktails to pair. Super simple, but effective nonetheless, as these sorts of stand-and-stir programs have often been at their best with a vibrant, fun host, which Claudia certainly is, so I can't be upset with that. However, if you've been keeping up with these videos, then you've heard me talk about this channel already, and I just want to take a sec to speak directly to those in charge of Byte themselves. Stop fucking viewbotting, you cheap, wussy little cunts. It's so fucking sad. And it's on every video now, including this new show. Like, I know you didn't get the audience you were hoping for. I know it must be worrisome to have to tell the big bad boss himself, Gordon Ramsay, that a venture he put his name on is flopping. But why try to hide it when the audience is seeing right through it? And by that I mean me, because I, and this is true, am your only outspoken supporter. This thing has been up for 3 months now, and I haven't heard a single person mention it in the wild. Even people I talk to who love cooking and cooking shows don't know what this is. I myself don't have the best stats on my channel, but what would be the point in paying for that number to be bigger? To boost my own ego? How pathetic. I do genuinely like a couple of the shows on this channel, and I hope that they do eventually reach the people that will appreciate them for what they are, but you guys, it's gotta happen organically, or else it's simply just not gonna feel earned. And TV, no matter how big or small, is a form of art, something that takes time to find its audience and respect. Be patient and stop forcing the view counts higher. Please, speaking as your number one fan, please. Daryl Dixon wrapped up this month, and holy shit, this is without a doubt some of the strongest material The Walking Dead franchises has produced in years. It's arguably better than some of the seasons of the main series. Like, y'all, if Ricardo, TikTok's premier Walking Dead snob, can acknowledge that this is doing something right, I mean, what more do you want? The Ned's Pod continues to truck along nicely with, once again, a solid crop of episodes that entertain and inform with charismatic hosts. You guys know how I feel about this. I'm almost certain this is the show that's appeared in the most amount of these episodes by now, and every time I find myself having less and less to say on it. Not that it's bad, not by any means, but I've just covered all the aspects of it many times before. So instead, why don't we turn to some other Nickelodeon theme projects that surely will be more interesting to discuss, because, they both kind of suck ass. Gibby's long-lost pilot was found this month by a dedicated fandom of lost media hunters who have been searching for this thing for years now. After initially finding the script and hearing behind-the-scenes chatter on why and or when Nick ultimately made the choice to decline picking it up. And in October, it was posted for all to see why Nick ultimately made the choice to decline picking it up. It's because it wasn't that great. Now, I want to preference something about this one. Most Nickelodeon shows do have weak pilots, even the ones I love. Drake and Josh, Big Time Rush, School of Rock, Side Hustle, all shows I have loads of respect for, all start off way worse than what they'd become, especially Side Hustle. Like, you know what? I've talked such a good game about this one. It's super underrated, one of the best Nick shows ever. Let me just prove to y'all that I understand why some people wouldn't like this because of its opening scene.
It's Friday!
Let's dance!
My favorite clothes are Pam!
My dad, sisters, my...
and... out of rhymes, but don't care because it's the weekend!
I promise you, if you power through it, it gets way better. But the first time I watched that, I physically put myself in the fetal position. It is bad.
It's the weekend!
So yeah, Nickelodeon, as much as I would take a bullet for them in a main bowling alley, doesn't have the best track record of great first impressions. But even ignoring that, Gibby presents itself in such a way that feels so unnatural and distant to what we know. Maybe it's because I'm such a huge iCarly fan, but I think that's kind of the point here. If diehard iCarly fans like me can't even get invested, who was this show made for? Because just straight up, the idea of Gibby mentoring and befriending a bunch of middle schoolers sounds awful. Look, I mean, there are people who may have worked at the network at some point, who if hypothetically were given the premise that they as adults would be working on a series with tweens where their character becomes super close best buds with them, would absolutely jump at the chance to do so. Noah Monk is one of them, because by all accounts, it seems like he was on board with it up until the network pulled the plug. I still don't fully understand why they at least didn't give it a chance. Maybe it's because they thought Sam and Cat was enough and they didn't want to overwhelm viewers with iCarly-related projects, but it probably worked out for the best overall, because once Monk was able to retire the Gibby brand, he got to be on the Goldbergs and started Sad World, both of which are excellent. But it is a shame that this is the only thing of this project we'll probably ever see. The series seems like something that could have grown into something special, like all those shows I mentioned prior, but what that would have actually looked like? Well, like the question, how many licks does it take to get to the Tootsie Roll center of a Tootsie Pop? The truth is that the world may never know. Hey look, we burned through the horror stuff pretty fast, and it's still Halloween. I gotta keep it on theme somehow. I had all the time in the world since I had my last vacation week this month from work, and other than grinding out a shit ton of content for y'all and cooking up some of the best grub I've had in years for the fam, I also got bored. Like, I know I like joking about my job, referencing it on this channel a lot, but I do genuinely like what I do, and it's the reason I stay. So by day 5 or 6 on vacation, after all the food in the house got eaten up, all the hangouts I planned were done, all the other shows I was excited for concluded their seasons, I was just scrolling trying to figure out what to watch next. And for some unexplainable reason, my cabin fever dumbass decided Zoe 102 was the best choice. Like, oh my god, y'all. If I owned a DeLorean, screw getting stock prices or lottery numbers or stopping Hitler from rising to power, I'm without question going to the head of Paramount Plus to right some fucking wrongs. Seriously, iCarly gets the boot, but we get Zoe 102, a movie with more than 102 things wrong with it. Stupid slapstick, stiff acting and delivery, boring set design, and some bitch named Lyric who gives real Peach Landon vibes. Incredible they're confident enough to point out anything regarding music, seeing that this movie has the worst, and I mean the worst, needle drops I have ever heard. Acapella? Don't speak? Good for you? Are you fucking kidding me? That last one is Disney property, you absolute tool bags. Side note, the same day I watched this, I coincidentally also saw that episode of The Big Bang Theory where Bernadette and Howard reveal they're pregnant and they all go to karaoke to celebrate, where they all sing songs with baby in the name. Yeah, you know that one, it's a classic. Explain to me, when karaoke became to comedy, what sex scenes are to dramas. Seemingly everywhere and way too long for their own good. Previously, the worst I ever saw was this Patrick John Pfluger movie called Loaded, where he sings a Corey Hart song. But now that I've seen Zoe 102... Guy was so passionate about doing karaoke to Limp fucking Bizkit, to the point where he goes hoarse the next goddamn morning. But honestly, it's pretty fitting, seeing how Fred Durst is just as big of a dick. It feels like a bad cutaway from a season 19 Family Guy episode. Half the plot is supposed to be a parody of these cheesy dating shows with the dumbest character I have ever seen. Like, this dude who's the main star of this show that Zoe has to keep an eye on, he's like if Joey Tribbiani was put in a dehydrator and concentrated to his maximum stupidity. Like, I enjoy dumb, stupid humor. This is, after all, built off of a Nick sitcom that we all grew up knowing wasn't really the best TV, but we all love it regardless. And I know famously I have never been a fan of Zoe 101. I've talked about it many times on this channel. But even as a standalone film, this just does not work. If it's not painfully annoying or cringy, it's predictable as fuck. Oh, what's this? Zoe and Chase are doing another will they, won't they setup? Come on, give me a break. Take a wild guess if they do or not. Yeah, obviously. Zoe 102 is an absolute mess on all levels. It's the worst example of an unnecessary, poorly thought out reboot that I've seen yet. Because as underwhelming as some folks thought How I Met Your Father or iCarly 2021 were, at least those were shows. they had time to develop and grow if things weren't working, which they very much did by the end. And no, I'm not over it. I will never be over it. Stop canning good television, you greedy, brain-dead, hairy little weasels. Zero 102 didn't even get the courtesy of that. It had one shot and missed it by a fucking mile. What a shame. Oh, and why the fuck are Thomas Lennon and Miss Pat here? Is the strike hurting that bad? Good lord. Recently, I've been in a routine of watching the Animation Domination Block with my brother, and we both agree Dan Harmon's new series, Crapopolis, is pretty bad. I feel bad because I always wish I was able to vibe with his work like everyone else does, but I just do not understand this guy's sense of humor. Rick and Morty, Community, and now this one. I've tried, honestly, but it's simply just not my cup of tea, with this one being the most grounded of all his work, I'd say. With its premise set up as an archetypal, dysfunctional family sitcom set in ancient Greece. Not a bad idea, certainly a lot to draw from that, but sadly, its execution falls flat with weak jokes and trite plot points. It's just a bit too cliche to be super laugh-out-loud funny, and overall just seems like a waste of a solid cast. And the last big project I watched this month was actually another movie that I was intrigued by that I kept putting off seeing for whatever reason, and when I finally got to check it out, I had some mixed thoughts on it, and that was Bottoms. So up front, I absolutely love that this movie essentially reinvigorated the appetite for R-rated comedies in the general audience. Half because I love comedy of all kinds, it's my favorite genre of entertainment, and because the cast here is wonderful, and is absolutely the best part of this flick, deserving all the praise they've received over the past few months. In particular, Marshawn Lynch, who, without question, is a showstopper in every scene that he's in. This dude is so fucking funny, it's borderline unfair. Between this and Stars on Mars, I would say he's up there now as someone who I will totally seek out whenever he's included in future shows and movies. Of course, our leading ladies do a good job as well. Rachel Sennett co-writing this feels very natural given how she plays this character. Her chemistry with everyone is very fluid and charming. This cast works well. But unfortunately, everything else, in my opinion, was average to poor. The main issue I had was the pacing. There were a lot of moments that felt rushed or came too early in the story to feel fully believable. All this discourse about how movies are too long nowadays, and here's a rare example of a film that's a bit too short. I feel like if there was maybe 20 to 25 more minutes to expand on some of the side plots and minor characters, it would have helped the whole of the story feel more impactful. And to be honest, I didn't really love the ending. I won't spoil it in case you want to watch it for yourself, but it took a really strange turn that I just didn't fully buy into. When I initially was pitched that this was a coming-of-age teen comedy, my mind immediately went to Booksmart because one, it's one of my favorite movies of all time, and two, it's a grounded, relatable story that, in spite of how wild and experimental it gets at times, never goes too over the top where it can't land the plane back on its tracks. Bottom, however, throws that idea way out the window and fully embraces the over-the-top absurdity of it all, which isn't necessarily a bad thing, it's just not what I thought it was going to be. My expectations were just different than what I assumed it was imitating, but that does make me want to rewatch it knowing how it all plays out. In fact, I think this is a prime example of a movie that will get better with multiple watches. I'm betting I'll find things and pick up on stuff I didn't notice before, and I'll probably appreciate it as a whole more the longer I sit with it. And on that note, it is solid. If still maybe a little overhyped, seeing people were touting it as the best teen comedy in decades, which, again, Booksmart is right there. But overall, it's a fun time waster that has no shortage of peaks to balance out its fair share of valleys. Seriously though, with all these movie reviews, I wonder what it would be like to have a whole channel dedicated to film discussions. Oh, and I've been watching the Marble Olympics 2023 season, Go Speeders. And that's everything I watched this month. Thank you for watching this video, everybody. If you enjoyed, be sure to subscribe, as we have just a couple more left before we end the year off with a big project that'll wrap up this little mini series up real nice, and I'm really excited to show you guys it. It's something that y'all are definitely not going to want to miss, let me tell you. Thanks for liking and commenting when you do and sharing the videos out. I always appreciate it. I want to wish you guys a great rest of your day. Take care, and we'll see you in the next one.